Next chapter. Diplomacy using beauty. Between the 16th and the 17th century in the Philippines and in Japan, and then in Macau, Jesuit missionaries committed themselves to the teaching of the visual arts and of architecture, to embellish their churches or missions, to produce devotional artworks, and to train the novices and the youth of those countries. After all, in the same century, Agostino Mascardi of Society of Jesus proclaimed that painting, quote, is the teacher of the people, because the common people, who are poorly equipped for understanding and letters and the children, have no other book than painting. Thus, in 1583 in Japan, was founded the Seminar of Painters by the Italian Jesuit Giovanni Di Niccolò, a painter from Nola. Subsequently, Brother Andrea Pozzo became the leader of a workshop or training center in Rome, where he taught, quote, in a wide attic of the Jesuit College in Rome, entering which you would have seen students of various nations, some studying architecture, other drawings, those carving coppers and those oil painting, these tempera paintings and other engaged to put, and the press, those prints you would have seen in the beautiful and rare books of his Prospettiva. Castiglione arrived in China in 1715. A letter of Castiglione from Lisbon to Father General Michelangelo Tamburini, 1714, February 22nd, explains that the painter had requested to be sent to China, quote, his desire mission, and that he had done some paintings in the Jesuit College of Coimbra that had brought him to his fame to the Portuguese court, so that Queen Maria Anna of Austria had ordered him the portraits of her children, delaying for a year his trip to Asia. So he was a good painter before coming to China. This is another item that we should remove out of several publications which deny the capacity of Giuseppe Castiglione to be just as famous in Europe as he would have been in China. Therefore, the Jesuits in Beijing were expecting someone like Castiglione, an artist who could paint portraits and perspective illusions for the imperial court, and who knew how to work and teach in the applied arts, enamel on ceramics, metal and brass. In the exhibition, you will see a fan painted by Castiglione. In 1715 in Beijing, reigned at the age of 62 the same Kanshi known in Europe thanks to a biography written by another Jesuit, the Portrait historique de l'Empereur de la Chine by Father Bouvet. The book, printed in 1697 and translated into Latin by Leibniz, compared France and China. Louis XIV, to whom the text was addressed, and the same Kanshi. The Manchurian emperor was described as follows, quote, the happy predisposition that God has instilled in his heart, together with the sciences, the fine arts, and the affection that this prince shows towards our religion, give us the opportunities to predict that one day he will be, perhaps, the destroyer of idolatry in China. End of quote. However, this was an illusion. An apology of the Jesuit mission at the Qing court. Kanshi, follower of the Tibetan Buddhism, as many Manchurians, did not convert to Catholicism. Indeed, he became angered against the papacy. Upon his personal opening with an edict of religious tolerance of 1692, the church demonized the relationship of the Jesuits with the court of Beijing, angering the monarch. In a phase of attack to the systems, also free and too proud of the Society of Jesus, their adapting to the Chinese culture was criticized as a sign of a laxity, and their loyalty or obedience to the sovereigns of the Celestial Empire appeared as a dangerous independence from Rome. It is not a surprise then that the paintings of Brother Castiglione often carry handwritten inscription with only his Chinese name, followed by square seals with red characters. Constant is the wording both for etiquette and tribute to the Manchurian court, which read, painted with respect by the servant, Lan Shenin, coming from the west of the sea. In the celestial empire, Castiglione and Lan Shenin had therefore to play the role of appearing as more than one person, or as two persons in one. Years before, he had learned to operate not only as an artist, but as a Jesuit artist, whose competent creativity, according to the precept and Jesuit esprit de corps, should not be an end in itself. In addition, in Beijing, he understood to be and appear originally from somewhere else, the west of the sea, whose figurative culture, through the creation of innovative style of painting, could bridge with the language and art techniques of his new Asian homeland, going so far as to be of service, but always to, quote, attract the Manchurian monarchs towards the Jesuits. Indeed, Castiglione got recognition at court, although his artistic career had cold reactions from some more traditionalist Chinese critics. Surely Castiglione empathized with the sophisticated culture that sheltered him, a point raised in a letter of 1733 to Father General François de Retz, in which Brother Joseph gave account, quote, of a rather extravagant sheet of stone which had in the middle a vein looking like a pyramid with various portions of circles, end of quote. Castiglione felt that this object of wonder was perfect to express the Mandarin aesthetics and its contact with nature. Quote, the Chinese use similar stones placed in a frame with 2 feet in the lower part and place them standing on tables so that both sides can be seen, end of quote. With great humility, he recommended to place it in Rome among the prestigious collections of the Society of Jesus, in what he called our gallery in Rome. I need to underline that the painter was at the Manchurian court when the evangelization mission began by the Jesuits at the court of the last and fallen Ming was heading towards a lull and then towards a scorching failure. Already in 1717, all the missionaries were expelled, with the exception of scientists and artists in direct service of the court. Yet at the beginning of the 18th century, almost 300,000 Christians were active in the Celestial Empire. It's worth dwelling on this aspect. Some missionaries of the Loyola family realized that to bring the gospel to sophisticated cultures such as those of Japan and China, it was necessary to come down off their perch. The Jesuits had to be ambassadors of human and even humanistic values, but always for the greater good of souls and the glory of God. Those values were to involve both the upper six of those countries and the generality of Asian society. Only in that manner, Jesuit missionary could hope to sprinkle Asian cultures with Christian concept and to put those notions in power at the time of an authentic encounter among people of goodwill. If the men of goodwill will have been at court or among the highest bureaucracy, there was the conviction that for emulation, even the less educated or less important on the social scale would better accept the novelty of Christianity, including some oddities, among which the rejection of having concubines. Very important matter. By promoting fair comparison without contrasting the codes of conduct of others, conversing and even listening to the native spiritual or philosophical traditions, strong personalities as Alessandro Valignano and Matteo Ricci thought that there was a possibility of translating the words of Christ in the language of others. They further hope to place the world in an evolution of the human soul that would involve all, on all latitudes. The Jesuits had identified as key elements of their apostolate both the mastery of the Chinese language and a grasping of the Chinese sense for artistic beauty. Dense Castiglione, with the bridge of his painting, represented an experiment of aesthetic cohabitation and of enculturation in a rarefied context, a cultural world complicated by academicians and xenophobia. In 6 to 7 years, Castiglione learned both the major local techniques to alternate them to the Italian oil paintings, for example, the watercolor and ink painting with the Chinese brush, and the use of special media such as paper and silk. I am convinced that in China, Castiglione wanted to appear a disciple of his confrere Andrea Pozzo, especially in the now lost religious works he prepared in Beijing. Saint Joseph was the patron of the Beijing mission, and there were 3 Jesuit churches. Brother Ferdinando Bonaventura Moggi from Florence was the architect and of the rebuilding of St. Joseph Church under the supervision of the rector and famous geographer Xavier Friedel. In November 1729, describing to Superior General Tamburini the works in St. Joseph Church, Moggi explained, "The altar is similar to that of the chapel of San Luigi Gonzaga in Roma. Yet I could not excuse myself for my work to show to your paternity the changes that were made in this altar to suit it to the place and to the country. This can also be said of the entire church, and that which differs to Europe architectural style is largely dissimulated in order to accommodate to the Chinese taste. It is important here to accommodate to the taste of the country and of its people, who are in their praise and in their criticism marvelously consistent." Here Moggi worked closely with Castiglione, who painted the vaults and the fake dome of St. Joseph, demonstrating to the same Jesuits an appropriate depth to the illusionistic knowledge of Andrea Pozzo. This is clear in Moggi's words: "The vaults of St. Joseph are all painted by Brother Giuseppe Castiglione in a very beautiful style, but above all he achieved marvels with the fake dome, painted on a flat frame, making its rising effect and overall very bright with light and dark so well contrasted." End of quote. Castiglione and Moggi surely took inspiration from the engravings, this is one, of the famous Perspectiva Pictorum et Architectorum, published 1693 by Andrea Pozzo, of which at least 2 copies were with the Jesuits of the Nantan Church in Beijing. In this context, it should be mentioned the publication of the Shi Tzu-e, 1729 and 1735, a Mandarin adaptation of Pozzo's book on perspective by the scholar Nian Xiao, assisted by Castiglione. Right in the preface, quote, "Master Lan," end of quote, is referred as the foreign expert with whom Nian Xiao shared ideas to understand the linear perspective of the Westerners and then pass it on to the Chinese. Even in the destroying church complex of the Nantan and that of the Portuguese College, one could see other works by Castiglione, probably painted in oil and fresco with references to Pozzo's inventions. However, those artistic references have been framed in a Chinese setting to make them appreciable both by the Jesuits and by the Chinese dignitaries who could see them. An admired reaction to the perspective illusion by Castiglione came from the writer Yao Shi Yuan, who decided to narrate the creations of Lan Xianin at the Nantan Church because, quote, "The painting in perspective was not found in our ancient Chinese times, but it is so beautiful that it is a shame that the people of antiquity have never seen it." For this reason I take special note of it. Yao describes in great details the sizable tromblail of Castiglione, among them some wall paintings in perspective. With deception, the showed magnificent Chinese objects, jades, ivories, a vase with a fan of peacock feathers, bright of various colors, visible within some Chinese-style buildings, open with beautiful bamboo curtains rolled up. All of this fake, evidently. Castiglione and Moggi knew which path to follow for their creativity in China. They had to address it to the Jesuits in Rome, to the converted Chinese, and to the Qing court. The reference models defined in the recent figurative lesson of the order, the altar of San Luigi Gonzaga in the Chiesa del Gesù in Roma, the perspective illusions of Pozzo in Sant'Ignazio, in the Chiesa di Sant'Ignazio, and the Stanze di Sant'Ignazio next to the Church of the Gesù in Rome. For this reason, Castiglione, in 1729, writing to Michelangelo Pamburini, declared himself, "I am a Pozzo student." In the same letter of 1729, Giuseppe proposed to print some engravings after the preparatory drawings of his painting, to use them as missionary art. Castiglione explained that he had consulted with Brother Moggi, who would prepare the metal plates after the approval of the superiors. He also underlined that the project, if conducted only by the two brothers coadjutors and not by outsiders, would have shown that the Jesuit in Beijing did not sit around, but were operating for the greater glory of God. Let us imagine then the frustration of the two Jesuits, who could not bring to the attention of the Manchu court the missionary works, seeing the persecution against the Christians by the ruler of that time, the Emperor Yongzhen. Conversely, Castiglione was convinced that his new Pozzo-like volume would be successful in Europe as a work of missionary devotion, as a new curiosity coming from China, basically symptomatic of Jesuit accommodation and inculturation. Brother Giuseppe even hoped to make some money to reinvest in the same Beijing mission. There are two engravings by the German engraver Klauber. This is one, perhaps drawn from works of Castiglione in Beijing, but the project didn't go any further, or at least we don't have any evidences in Rome. This is in the archives of Society of Jesus in Rome. In the attempt to improve Yongzhen's negative opinion of the apostolate among the Chinese, Castiglione was employed by the Jesuit leaders in Beijing with the role of an artist diplomat. In other words, the high quality of his paintings could interest the wary monarch. In the fall of 1723, the president of the Department of Astronomy, the Bavarian Jesuit, Ignazio Schegler, communicated to General Tambulini that Yongzhen wanted to put to the test the hand and brush of Castiglione. Kegler emphasized that Castiglione had been highly rewarded also by the 13th son of Kangxi, Prince Yin Xiang, the half-brother of the emperor, who became Minister of Finance in 1723, as well as superintendent of the state tax, including that for pigments. For the new emperor, he was in charge of looking after his foreign employees. This was surely the start of a familiarity with Castiglione, to whom Yin Xiang ordered many works, including a scroll depicting a Chinese fable and 40 painted fans. Father Kegler explained to General Tamburini in Rome the ability of Brother Giuseppe to accommodate to both the general Chinese taste and to the peculiar preferences of Yongzhen. I repeat that the idea was to ease tensions and bolster the emperor's favor to useful members of the Society of Jesus. Kegler wrote, Our dear Castiglione had been occupied daily at the palace with his art. A European brush must accommodate to the Chinese ingenuity and taste, even if the artist is highly skilled. And his art has been favorably judged by the 13 prince and the emperor, first in enamel paintings, like that, then in the more usual technique in oil or watercolor. By imperial orders, he had to send the emperor everything that he had already done. We could say that his works won the favor of the emperor, as on several occasions he had praised the artist and sent him gifts. The information is from the Jesuit astronomer and cartographer Karel Slavicek. The specific diplomacy of Brother Castiglione, consisting of art and of all respect for the powerful host culture, truly began with a tribute he made to the new emperor, when the missionaries were in serious danger in the province of Fujian. This is actually referring to other missionaries. In the spring of 1723, the Jesuits had been accused of practices that seemed immoral to the local administrators, including men and women praying together. And doubts were entertained about their influence on children of both genders. They were therefore placed under the scrutiny of Governor Mambao, who was also suspicious of substantial sums of money that these, quote, barbarian priests, end of quote, collected and used to build religious buildings, which were quickly confiscated to be turned into public schools. With his mind weighted down by these problems, but eager to help, on 15 September 1723, Castiglione finished the sealed scroll entitled Gathering of Many Auspicious Signs. Castiglione had decided to paint some good luck symbols for the first year of the reign of Yongzheng. They were effective metaphors based on real things picked up from the imperial garden. In the accompanying inscription to the scroll, he wrote, in the first year of the reign of Emperor Yongzheng, every kind of good omen emerged. Double grain stems grew in the fields, and lotus flowers bloomed in the small lake of the Forbidden City. Your servant Lan Shenin has respectively painted these auspicious signs on a vase after careful observation with the purpose of commemorating these events, September 15, 1723. Castiglione painted his bouquet after having arranged it with care in a Song Dynasty vase. He painted with such realism that to this day we feel that we are almost in the presence of a delicate 13th century ceramic masterpiece with its elegant blue and green neck. The double lotus flower in three different states, bud, flower, and fruit, also seem to be painted as if he had just picked up, and at the same time, as Castiglione says, after careful observation. Castiglione also imitated the real leaves of the lotus flower sheaves of foxtail, millet, flowers and leaves of other plants, all with minute precisions and with a particular use of shadows, very Italian, but employing Chinese painting techniques. Castiglione had to work within the limits of his capacity to transpose graphically, concept and terms from a complicated tradition of analogies. It could be that the double lotus flower alludes to happy marriage. We also detect a good luck wish for prosperity in the first year of the reign of Yongzheng because of the representation of grain sheaves. Those sheaves, Brother Giuseppe called gu, edible grain, the Chinese call simply su, or small rice, xiao mi. The type of grain here depicted, foxtail millet, is common in northern China. The people of the north and Beijing use it in a popular soup, which Yongzhen liked very much. So that in 1724, he tried to spread this earthly meal to the southern provinces after a great shortage of local rice because of heavy flooding. The term soup became associated with good food policy, moving from the meaning of an edible plant to a metaphor for wealth based on well-organized agricultural policy. This was the responsibility and traditional concern of Chinese emperor as a sign of the so-called mandate of heaven. One of the classical tests of good land management was the notes from the emperor about the importance to the emperor about the importance of growing grains, written many centuries before by Cao Cuo for the Han dynasty. In the text, Cao had used the proverbial saying, grain, su, is the greatest of all resources for an emperor, given that the practice of farming has political value for every ruler. In 1727, Castiglione sketched other sheaves of foxtail millet for drawings to be printed to accompany a communication from Yongzhen attesting to the productivity of farming under his wise auspices in all territories of the empire. The symbolism of the locks, a strong, robust plant that grows from the muddy base of Pand, plays a Buddhist reference. This, along with the medicinal purpose of the lotus and the presence of the double sheets of foxtail millet as a sign of prosperity for all the population, tend to support the idea that Castiglione had been guided by a member of the court, perhaps Prince Yan Xiang, well aware of the specific interest of Yongzhen. In the era of Yuan and the Ming, it was common to paint such depictions of plants as good luck symbols arranged in beautiful vases. For the Manchurian court, the novelty of this painting by Castiglione lay in the depiction devised by one of the foreign missionaries who had entered into the fray. Castiglione had devised this gift for the emperor as both a technical and diplomatic surprise. Thence, his own inscription and the antique symbols bore testament to his capacity to adapt. The inscription imitates the printed style known as Song style. And he also copied a celadon ceramic, an expression of the Song decorative culture, which seems an intentional choice. Castiglione here demonstrates his familiarity with the collection of the Manchu emperors, who, despite their not being Han, collected iconic Song artifacts to show their adherence to the highest of Chinese aesthetic ideals. Song dynasty China reached high levels of material and economic progress, primarily due to the prosperous farming as a result of the revolutionary introduction of early ripening Vietnamese rice and heavy urbanization. These factors had fostered the developments of art and culture, including private and public patronage, with the Academy of Imperial Painting at the forefront. So, in the difficult year of 1723, Castiglione somehow understood all of this. He might have learned to understand the thin line in China separating and joining arts and craftsmanship. This element of refinement extolled poets and painters, but at the same time, Chinese intellectuals were excited by innovation in ceramics, as demonstrated by Cixi's, by Song ceramist, those ceramics that perfected Celadon with the rich undertones in grey, blue, green, and with the fascinating spider web crazy. Moreover, Castiglione's use of Celadon vase created a figurative, harmonious and coherent solution to match the pale undertones of the flowers collected in the vase. Trying to imagine Castiglione's thoughts when making formal choices of his work, we find an echo of the Italian painting tradition, and in particular that of Milan, inspired by the sober taste of Cardinal Federico Borromeo. We sense this both in the controlled rhetoric of the pictorial presence emanating from Giuseppe's scroll, and those are two elements that go back in the rigorous idea of the Counter-Reformation. Does this very work, by Castiglione, ideologically ties to the late 16th century more than to the arabesque of the late 17th century? As example, we can cite Caravaggio's Basket of Fruit at the Biblioteca Ambrosiana di Milano, the realistic element seen in the works of Simone Peterzano, Caravaggio's teacher, and in Giovan Battista Crespi, known as Cerano, all that we can see in Milano and in the Jesuit churches of Milano. To further clarify which kind of Jesuit art Brother Giuseppe may have absorbed, we would again mention Andrea Pozzo, particularly some flower paste in sumptuous vases seen in 1680s frescoes of For the Stanze di Sant'Ignazio in Rome. An interesting analogy can be drawn with the paintings of flowering vases and frames painted by the Flemish Jesuit Daniel Segers, a student of Jan Brueghel, who also worked for the Milano Cardinal Borromeo. It is impossible to say now if Castiglione ever had a chance to see these Flemish compositions. Surely Lanchenin was familiar with the emblematic value of flower and plants in the Christian iconography, such as the symbol of Mary, used among the Jesuits to foster Jesuit preachers' great eloquence in sermons. So I have already spoken for too long, so I will salute you here. Okay.